team member, etc. And sir is also having a number of conference papers and journal papers to his credit. So we welcome you, sir, for this second FTP, and hope we'll have a nice interactive session. And all the questions that will be asked by the participants, we request all the participants to put forth your questions in the chat box, and we will consolidate and we will be presenting to the sir at the end of the section, so that sir can present it without any interruption. Thank you. Now the floor is open to Dr. Bhakiraj.
I first thank Kalyan University for giving me this opportunity to have a talk in this FTP, particularly focusing on brain computer application. So the topic for this session is functional near infrared spectroscopy. We are trying to understand how this technique can be a promising BCI technique. So the overview of the presentation is what is a BCI. So we will define the BCI, then the methodology, then the various areas where we can use this BCI. Then we will move on to the functional neuroimaging methods for BCI. So this first two content, yesterday I was listening to the first speaker. He has covered it in a detailed way, but I will just give a brief intro on these two. And then we will see how BCI can be used for communication. And then our main agenda will be focusing on the functional near infrared spectroscopy, where we will try to understand the working principle, design and development. And then when we practically use it, or when you have an application, how we face some issues, how we overcome these issues. Then a specific case study on the application of FNIRS for the cerebral cognition study in prefrontal cortex of human brain. Then once the study is presented, we will try to understand how we can analyze the NIRS signal. Then we will try to understand BCI-related characteristics of hemodynamics brain signal. Then for brain-computer interface application, we will move on to the information encoding, how it can be done. And then if time permits, I will present the second case study. But the second case study is on a multiple choice FNIRS-based communication BCI. But it is not done by me. It is done in the Manchester University, where I will present if time permits. And then I will present a short YouTube video to show the overview of FNIRS performance with motion. And then we will summarize with the advantage and limitation. So this is what my overview of presentation. So we will try to understand what is a brain-computer interface. So the definition says it's a system which connects a human or animal brain with a computer. I think this introduction or the definition we have discussed in detail in the yesterday session. So I'll just say where do we use it. So you can just see this technique can be used for controlling an external device through your thought process or through your brain activity without having to rely on the motor output. A little bit later, I'll just show you what is this relaying on the motor output. So this BCI technique, where we can use it, what are the areas where you have the application? So it can be used for researching, it can be used for enhancing, it can be used for assisting a person, or it can be helpful in repairing or replacing cognitive or sensory motor functions. So in the left side, you can see this block diagram. I think this block diagram we have seen in detail in the last day lecture. So this is the general methodology of BCI. So where you can just see the sensor or the electrode, which is placed in the brain, and then we try to activate it. So you can just see here the signal is being acquired, and then we need to do some signal processing, and then we need to extract the features of the related to the activity that the person has done, and then we need to translate these features into an action or into a command that the device can take it and it can implement the action that the subject is not able to perform. So we just see this animation. So you would have understood now what is the issue if your body does not support your intention. So you can just see in a healthy person, this diagram A, in the healthy person, the primary motor area send movement commands to the muscle via spinal cord. So if you are a healthy person, you don't have any issue. But in the diagram B, you can just see in a paralyzed people, this pathway is interrupted. You can just see the red patch indicating that this pathway is interrupted. So because of this interruption, the person is not able to do his activity and you call them as paralyzed people. Now how do I help in these cases? You can just see a computer-based decoder is used which translates this activity into a commands for muscle control. So you can just see in the diagram C, we have an additional thing, we call it as a BCA application, where the interruption you can overcome it by using a specific application. So this is just the brief overview about what is BCI and where the BCA can be used. And next we'll move to the second part, is about functional neuroimaging methods for BCI. So this slide gives you the information about the various techniques that can be used for building the BCI application. So on the left side, you can just see the signal from EEG, or it can be from fMRI, or it can be from NIRS. So these three, broadly you say it is a non-invasive, and then we acquire it. As the methodology block diagram says, I need to extract the feature and then I need to translate these features into control signal or command signal, which can activate the additional external device that is going to help the person. On the other side, you can just see the invasive techniques like ECOG, electrocardiography, where on the cerebral cortex, the electrodes are going to be placed and then you can record it. So it is you remove a part of the skull and then you place the electrode directly on the cortex. And if I am interested in knowing about a single neuronal activity, in that case I can even go for internal means putting an electrode inside the cerebral cortex, and then I can measure the signal. In whatever the way you pick the signal, and later half of this BCI part is the same, the methodology is the same. So the neuroimaging modalities, broadly you have five techniques I have taken into consideration. There are other techniques are also available. So the first three techniques are, I say it is about the electrical activity based. And the next two techniques is about hemodynamic based. Hemodynamic, it will later in this component. So this EEG, what is EEG? I think mostly would have already aware in the last class, they are in the last FTP session, we have discussed more in detail about what are the various waves of EEG, and then what are the different ways we can acquire, and the other things that we have. And this is also another electrical based thing, where we look for electrical related magnetic field and then we try to acquire it. We call it as a magnetoencephalograph. Then the third one is electrocardiography. So it is also about the electrical activity. So in general, I'll just say the first three techniques is more about the electrical activity based. The next technique is fMRI, where I said it is hemodynamic, where we are going to detect the changes in the blood oxygenation level signal that occurs in response to the electrical activity that is happening in the specific region of the brain. So you're trying to understand, now you have a neurovascular coupling. I mean, when you do an activity, the neurons are get activated to meet the neurons' energy demand. We have in that specific region, blood flow increases or blood flow decreases. It depends on whether that region is active or whether that region is not involved in when the particular activity is done. So we try to understand the hemodynamics and then we try to measure. So this is fMRI. And then coming to the next technique is fNIRS, it's near infrared spectroscopy. In some things they also say it as fNIRS, functional near infrared spectroscopy, where we try to detect localized changes in the cortical activity and associated blood flow in the optical window 650 nanometer to 900 nanometer. So where this light can penetrate approximately to a depth of 3 centimeter below the surface of the scalp, and it can be used for studying the hemodynamic changes that is happening when a subject does a particular mental or motor activity. So this slide will give you a comparison between the electrophysiological or the electrical activity versus the hemodynamic methods. So you can just see EEG, ECOG, magnetoencephalography, these are all direct methods where the activated neuron related postsynaptic potentials or postsynaptic potential related magnetic field we try to measure. So it's a direct method. But the last two technique is indirect method. Why do you say indirect method is? You can understand now why do I say this? Yes. We need to understand neuro-related vascular coupling, and the vascular coupling related changes we try to measure using the fNIRS and fMRI. So the clear discrimination between the electrical and the hemodynamic method, I hope you would have understood now. Now you can just see the advantage and disadvantage of functional neuroimaging methods for our application. Our application here today is for brain-computer interface. So you can just see the metrics or on what basis that the signal is being or the methodology is being compared. Yes, the first metric is resolution, where we say the temporal resolution is and the spatial resolution. So the temporal resolution is something about how fast your system is able to sense the changes that is happening in the brain related to the particular mental activity that you perform. Spatial is how in the cerebral cortex, how closer that we are able to understand. The depth pervasion is whether you are able to understand the superficial layer of the brain, or whether you are going to understand the underlying organelles, which is going to have a specific function related to the mental task. So how depth I am able to understand. Then the brain coverage. I mean the entire scalp or the entire brain you can study. And then it's about invasive or non-invasive. And the last one is about mobility. So if you see the comparison, you don't have a best technique. So some technique may have a good resolution, some technique may have in terms of mobility or in terms of invasiveness, it may have an advantage. So I'll just say for a specific BCA application, what modality or what method I need to select, it all depends on your access to the specific method, and then using this method, what is the specific application that we are going to develop? I mean, what BCA application that you are going to develop. Based on that, you need to select the specific method and then you need to work on it. So, the application is the application is for communication. Communication is nothing but the human being lives according to its communication capacity. So losing the capacity for communication means losing the life. So you need to understand the importance of communication. And in the different ways by which the person have the loss of communication, it may be ALS disease, or it may be a stroke which affect the speech area, or it can be a brain injury, or it can be a muscular dystrophy. So how do I help these people who have loss of communication? So you can augment what is the remaining that, or I would say what is the ability that they have, you can augment. If you don't have a ability to communicate, and how I can, or I can give an alternate choice of communication. So this is where your BCI comes into picture. So let's just say BCI for communication. In the last lecture, you would have heard about this slow particle potential sensory motor rhythm, the P300 based BCI, but I'm not going to focus on these things. But my focus will be on this FNARS based BCI. So you can just see the next few slides will discuss about the functional magnetic resonance imaging technique, and then we will move on to the specific application. So this technique, it works on the principle of Beer-Lambert's law. So you can just see now, we try to send in a specific range of light, I mean a specific wavelength of light. So you can just see in this absorption spectrum of hemoglobin, so where the red color graph indicates the absorption extinction coefficient graph, we plotted against the wavelength for oxyhemoglobin, and then HP is reduced or deoxyhemoglobin. So where you would have already aware, our human body is mainly 70% is composed of water, which is one of the major absorbing agent present in our human body. But in this wavelength window, or I would just say in the optical window, 650 to 900 nanometer, this water that which is present 70% in our human body, it is transparent. It is not going to absorb the light whatever we send in the wavelength range from 650 to 900 nanometer. So I can just send the light. So you can just see in the rightmost, you have a source that is being sending the light inside, and then I have a detector, and based on the hemodynamics that is happening here, part of the light will be absorbed and part of the light will be scattered, and then it will be detected by the detector that is being used to sense the specific wavelength. So I'm going to send a light with a specific wavelength, and then I'm going to detect the scattered light. So I have the intensity of the light what I'm sending in, and then I have the intensity of light what the receiver is going to receive. With this, I also used some parameters related to the wavelength specific for deoxyhemoglobin and oxyhemoglobin, and then I'm going to derive the absorption variation in with respect to the wavelength 1 and then with respect to the wavelength 2. And these two equations are simultaneous equation. I can just solve this simultaneous equation for the variable HV and then HVO. HV means reduced or deoxygenated hemoglobin. HVO2 or HVO is nothing but oxygenated hemoglobin. So I can get the the variation in the oxyhemoglobin and deoxyhemoglobin in terms of concentration change when the subject does the study. I mean the mental activity or whatever it is. So I said in the previous slide we need to select the wavelength. So you can just see here we select two wavelengths. One is specific for deoxygenated, the other one is specific for oxygenated hemoglobin. Once this wavelength is selected, we can go for a specific FNARS method. So we have three different FNARS method. So I'm not going to go in detail with the three techniques. I'll just say the one that we are going to see in detail today. So the one that is in the bottom, continuous wave FNARS. You can just see I'm going to send in a light with a specific intensity. So this light, because of this medium, so you can just see here it is baseline, I don't have any medium. So when the light passes through this pathway, the absorption happens, some is reflected back, some scattering. So I am having a lesser intensity as an output. But when I have an absorption medium, just see some of the light is being absorbed, I have a lesser intensity. When I have a scattering medium, the intensity what I receive is going to vary. So I'm going to measure these light intensities and then I'm going to derive using the modified wave Lambert's law the concentration change of oxy and deoxyhemoglobin. So this is how my methodology is going to be. So I'm going to have the NARS offload placed in the cerebral cortex region, that is your region of interest. And then I'm going to have a DAC to control the source and detector and what rate I need to acquire the source signal. And then I'm going to process it, I'm going to extract the features, and then I'm going to do the analysis. So we just see in this probe design, I have used wavelength 760 and 850 nanometer. It is in the form of LED light source. So it is obtained from US, from a company Epitex. And then the detector used for this study is the OPT-101, which is a transimpedance opto amplifier. This is from Texas Instruments, US. And you can ask me now, sir, you say you use a single detector, but you have two different wavelengths. So this spectral responsibility for this detector, it is more or less same for the 760 nanometer and also for 850 nanometer. So that is the reason why we use a single detector. Then you can just see this is the arrangement of the opcode, how you have it. So this is the, you can just see now the two light source, one in the 760 and the 850 nanometer is placed. And this is the detector and it has to be placed with a distance of 3 cm. Then you can just see now, since I use two different wavelengths, I cannot switch on the 760 and 850 nanometer at the same time. I need to ensure that only one source is switched on. For that purpose, I use a timing pulse which is synchronized with the detector response measurement. So you can just see here, I have a 1 millisecond duration during which the first LED will be switched on, and then the after that, I have a time delay of 1 millisecond, and then I have the second LED will be switched on. So I have this timing information, I have a single detector which will pick these responses. So this is how the probe of two channel that is being developed, which is fixed with the adjustable headband where we can wear it around the region of interest where you want to do the study. So this is the probe that I developed. And you can just see now, it is not necessary that always you need to develop a hardware, and this hardware, it is also commercially available. Now, whether you use a commercially available hardware or whether you develop the probe and then we use it, what are the practical and the procedural aspects of FNARS that we need to take into consideration? So this machine that is being shown here is from NARS Scout machine. It's one of the popularly available machine. But the only thing is the cost that the machine is bearing is very high, where when you have an funding, when you want to get it, it's very difficult to get it. It's closer to 60 lakhs or 50 to 60 lakhs. So I'll just say now, using this machine or using the developed probe, you can measure it. So when I say measure it, I need to place it on the scalp. You know that the scalp region will be covered with hair. Whereas when I use a EEG electrode, I need to prepare the scalp with the skin abrasion gel, and then I need to apply electrode gel, and then we need to place the electrode. But since this is an optical method, I no need to prepare the scan. But the practically you need to see if you have a very dense hair. In some cases, you may need to remove hair, but it's not necessary in all the cases. In some cases, you may need to remove the hair, and then we need to place the optode. So when I place the optode, where do I place it, and how do I take the reference? So this optode placement, it always takes its reference with already gold standard technique, that is the EEG, where we have a 10-20 read system as the reference read system. We use this reference read system, and then we try to place the optode in the region of interest. So you can just see here the sources, and this is the detector that is being used in this commercially available machine. Once the optodes are placed, now you can just understand. I already told you I can get the information up to a depth of 3 cm. So you can just see in this diagram. So if I place the sensor here, I can go to a depth of 3 cm. So whatever the region, the cerebral region, in this region, whatever the hemodynamics that is happening, I can study. But I cannot study the information that is, or the changes that is happening in a deeper layer or in the inner regions where you have the organelles like glial cephalon. If you have any changes, that regions you cannot study by using this FNARS method. And coming to one of the practical difficulty is always we try to study the region between a source and a detector. But you cannot study the region between two sources or region between two detectors. So you need to understand the region under study is always the region that is between the source and the detector. So these are the practical things that you need to take into mind when you try to use this FANRS for a specific application. So this is one of my PG student who is going to take up my test. I just said the experimental setup for the brain activity study. So you can just see here the optode, what we have done, 2 channels placed in the prefrontal cortex. And then the laptop is used for presenting the visual cue. The cue, I mean, what the subject has to perform. And then the same laptop is used for recording. And then I have this NI DAC to control the on time of the source, 760 nanometer, and then the 850 nanometer, and then to acquire the signal from the detectors. So with this setup, I have done a particular experiment called the cerebral oxygenation study in prefrontal cortex of human brain while solving arithmetic puzzles. So you can just see now in this study, we have tested it on 25 subjects. So the test involved solving a cue of an arithmetic puzzle. So we have 2 sets of arithmetic puzzles were used in this test. So you can just see this is the task one. I'll just say a simple task where the subject or the participant has to find the cells that make a sum of 10. So you can just see this matrix will be given in the form of in the paper where the subject has to round these cells where you have 2 numbers. When they sum, you get the answer 10. So you can just see for this typical problem, the solution is given here, the sample answer is given here. So this is what the subject is expected to perform. The second task is slightly complicated. So we discussed with the neurologists, and they say they have compared this task 1 and task 2, and they say it is slightly complicated. You can understand now why I say it is complicated. So it is a 3x3 matrix puzzle where the participant has to use the Calcudo. You would have heard about Sudoku. Right, it is a 3x3 matrix, which means that I can use the numbers 1, 2, 3. Similarly, in the columns, I can use the numbers only 1, 2, 3. And in each row, I can use 1, 2, 3 only once. This is, you would have already aware, you would have played. But it is Calcudo, where I can just see in the solid box, I can use the number 1, 2, 3. But the arithmetic operation when I perform between these numbers, the resultant answer should be 6. Similarly, the arithmetic operation here is addition. When I perform the addition of the four numbers that is present in this highlighted square box, the resultant answer should be 8. Similarly, when I subtract the difference between these two numbers, the resultant answer should be 2. So this is what the subject is expected to perform. So now you can understand why do I say it is slightly complex when I just compare it with the first puzzle. So this is the sample answer for the puzzle. So this is, you can just say 3 into 1 into 2, it is 6. So similarly, 1 plus 2 plus 2 plus 3, it is 8. So this is what the subject is expected to perform during this arithmetic task. So how do I, what is my experimental protocol? So I record the signal, I call it as a baseline signal for 10 seconds. And then the subject is asked to perform the task for 10 seconds. So whether the subject is asked to stop or whether he has to start the task, you're given auditory cue. So let us say I'm the subject, I'm going to take the task. If they say start the task, I will start performing the arithmetic operation. If they say stop, I need to stop it and I need to be very calm. So this is what the instruction through the auditory cue we presented to the subject. So this is called as an experimental protocol. And you can just see here, each task is performed for 5 tries. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 tries. And similarly, this protocol will be repeated for my first arithmetic cue and also for my second arithmetic cue. So this is one of my PG students who is taking the arithmetic task. So she is using the pen and then he is trying to solve the puzzle. During that time, the data were recorded. And this is the typical voltage variation that we get it for the experimental cue. So this is in the FP2, or I'll just say in the right prefrontal cortex, the response. And this is in the right prefrontal cortex response for 850 nanometer and then the 760 nanometer. I'm not going into the graph, a little bit later in the last graph, this is for the left prefrontal cortex. So here in this diagram, you can just see the BL means baseline and T means task or trial period and R is the rest period. So during the task, you can just see the magnitude of the voltage that the opt-out detector and then the amplifier, that is the OPD 101, whatever the response it gives, it is lesser. Why it is lesser, why the voltage that is being received lesser is, the intensity of light that the photo detector is going to receive is less. Why the intensity of the light that the photo detector is going to receive is less, it is because the moment you do the activity, if that region is actively involved, you're going to have neurovascular coupling. So in that region, the blood flow is going to be increased and which in turn is going to scatter the light and as a result, the intensity received is less. So this is the raw voltage value. And using this raw voltage value, calculated the absorption density and then using the two simultaneous equations for the wavelength 760 and 850, they solve it for the two variables, that is the oxyhemoglobin changes and then the deoxyhemoglobin changes. So the data messages, you can just see when the specific region it is involved in the activity, in that region you have the oxyhemoglobin concentration increases and then the deoxyhemoglobin decreases. When the subject try to withdraw from the task, it tries to come to the baseline. So when he repeats the next try, the similar response is being obtained. So this is for the various cues that the subject has performed. And this is for the second task for the 3x3 matrix puzzle that the subject has performed. So this is in the left prefrontal cortex for the task 2, how the result is for the entire experimental protocol duration. So now I have these recordings which has some variation with respect to time. I have a time series data. What do I do with this data? So I said I'm going to use these data for building a specific application. So So you can just see how do I build the specific application list. It's all based on how I'm going to analyze these data. So you can just see the analysis of this FNIRS signal. It can be, you have three broad ways. So it is not necessarily the analysis has to take only in these three ways. It can be in some other way also. If you have, there are other methodologies or emerging methodologies are also available. I have broadly classified into three different analysis techniques. One was activation analysis. The second analysis technique is connectivity analysis. And the third technique is lateralization analysis. I'll just go one by one in detail. So we'll just see this activation analysis. So in the previous case study, where I studied in the prefrontal cortex, in two regions, when I say with respect to 1020 lead that is used for recording EEG, the reference locations are FP1 and FP2. I call it as FP1 as a left prefrontal cortex, and FP2 is a right prefrontal cortex. So you can just see now, in these regions, I have acquired the signal, but now I want to know which region is more active when the subject does task 1 or task 2. I can do a comparison. So in my case, I have used only 2 channels. There are commercially available machines are there where I can cover the region of interest, like motor cortex region, or in the occipital lobe, I can do it. So first thing what we need to do is we need to filter the optical data to remove the signal arising from the systemic physiology. So where when I record, I may have some signals related to your the respiratory related changes happening in the hemodynamics, or the cardiac related hemodynamic changes, I need to remove it. That is the first process. Once the pre-processing is done, I can use modified Beer-Lambert's law. And then I can calculate change in the relative concentration of oxyhemoglobin, deoxyhemoglobin, this R is reduced, and then total hemoglobin is nothing but summation of oxy and deoxy as a function of time. So as I showed in the previous slide, I can have a plot which varies with respect to time. Now I can do a statistical analysis to understand which region is more active, which region is more involved in that particular activity when the subject has done it. So you can just see this type of analysis, we call it as an activation analysis. The second type of analysis that I can do is brain connectivity analysis. What do you mean by brain connectivity analysis is nothing but it refers to the pattern of connection and interaction between various units of, or I'll just say various subunits of brain. So let us say now I have the optodes placed in the entire cerebral cortex. When I do a specific activity, it is not necessary that my prefrontal cortex alone it has to be active. In some cases, some of my parietal lobe can also be active. So I can just study how good the electrode in the optode in the parietal and the frontal, how they are related to each other and how they are active. When I do this study, you call it as a connectivity analysis. So we just say it forms a distributed network within the different regions of the brain, communicate with each other when they study the specific task. So there are three types of connectivity analysis. One is, you call it as a structural connectivity, which describes the anatomical links between different units in the brain. With NIRS, I already told you, I'm going to get the information about to a depth of 3 cm. I'm not going to get the complete structural information or the anatomical information of the brain. So it is very difficult for me to do the anatomical or structural connectivity analysis with FNIRS. Then the second type of connectivity analysis that I can perform is functional connectivity. Functional connectivity means which describe the temporal correlation among with respect to time, how the different types of neurons or different types of regions in the brain, that is how actively they were involved. I can do this study with the FNIRS. So the third thing is effective connectivity, which describes about the causal relationship between distinct units within a nervous system. So with FNARS, I can do these types of connectivity analysis. With the data that I have from the FNARS, I can do these types of analysis. Then the third type of analysis that you can do is the lateralization analysis. So lateralization analysis is nothing but identifying, as you all aware, as a common person. Right, you have two hemispheres of the brain, so I can understand whether my right hemisphere is dominant when I perform a specific activity, or whether my left hemisphere is dominant when I perform this activity, or whether it is bilateral, whether both the hemispheres are equally involved when I perform this task. So you can evaluate or you can analyze the hemispherical dominance of one particular region over the other during the task or even during the rest state of the brain. So this analysis, you call it as a lateralization analysis. And then using this formula, it is shown here, I can derive the lateralicity index, which can give me the information about which side is dominant, or I can understand whether it is bilateral activation. So now you can understand with the FNARS, you can study the brain, and with these signal, I can do the analysis. The next part is how I relate or how I get the BCI relevant characteristics of this NARS or the hemodynamic signal. So you can just see a short animation. You can just see this short animation. So you can just see here, what is done here is, I'm giving, the subject is presented with a 100 millisecond checkerboard with the EEG when I record the response. You can just see neuroelectric response in yellow color. It instantly, with a latency in terms of milliseconds or microseconds, I get the response. But with hemodynamics, you have a delay, so we just say it is timing in seconds. I have a delay, and after the delay, I get the response. You can just see now, so this is the neuroelectric response, and this is the hemodynamic response for a stimulus which is presented for 100 milliseconds. So what do I understand here? I can understand clearly that I have a delay in the hemodynamic response. When I have a delay, let us say that I do an activity, but I get a response after 2 or 3 seconds delay, I get a response. Then this delay, when I want to do it in a real-time application, it may not be a good characteristics for this application. I always take into account the delay that's being passed in the hemodynamic signal, and then I need to build the application. So delay is one of the characteristics that you need to look in the hemodynamic signal when you want to extract BCI relevant characteristics. The second thing that you need to take into account is high single trial reliability. So when I do a task for multiple trials, in each trial you are able to get the response. So you would have seen in my experiment, I have did the task for 5 trials, the subject has did the task for 5 trials. And you would have seen in each trial, you have the response being evoked and you can measure it. So in this case also, you can just see the reticular patches is the duration where the subject has done the task, and it can be sensed with the rise in the peak. So this peak, what is shown in the bottom, it is nothing but the summation of I'll just say the average of all the trials that has happened here, the average response is shown here. So I can just say the moment the task is, this is an imaginary task, the subject has to imagine as if he is performing the task. So after a delay, Let me just see, after a delay of 1 to 2 seconds, after a delay of 1 to 2 seconds, I get the response. So this is the good feature with respect to the BCI. I have a very high single trial reliability with respect to the FNIR signal. Then the next feature that you need to understand is you have sufficient spatial resolution. So we just see here in this slide, I have just shown the subject has done three different mental activity. One is motor imagery, the other one is mental calculation, the third one is about inner speech, imagining the as if he is speaking something. Motor imagery is he has to imagine as if he is moving his right arm or left arm. Mental calculation is, as I just showed you, the arithmetic, the subject has to perform the arithmetic. Sometimes it may be on the paper, or sometimes he has to do it in the mind itself. He need not work out and then he need to do it. But you can just see here, you have specific regions in the brain or the specific parts of the cerebral cortex are active for each task. And you can also see that you may have some overlap in these regions. So what I'm trying to say here is, when I do a specific task, I have specific regions, the activation happens, I can study in that region and then I can record the signals. So this is the third BCI relevant characteristics that you need to take advantage of. Now coming to the next important aspect, this information encoding in NIR signal for BCI application. You just see, how can we enable patient to encode different information or intentions into differentiable FNIR signal? So the thing is, the best way to do the information encoding in FNIRS BCI is, it is not with respect to the FNIRS or any BCI technique, is simply you ask SRM question and then you just get the answer from the subject, whether he is going to say yes, no, like that, and what is the response to it. But when I want to build a specific application like deriving an external wheelchair or controlling an assistive aid, when I do this direct encoding just by asking a question and the answer yes or no, the getting the signal from the brain is very difficult. So this approach is not encouraged. Then what do I do now? Oh, you can just see in this slide, if I have a question, right, whether you have taken your breakfast in the morning, I should not say the answer, yes, I have taken or I have not taken, yes or no. Instead, if I say I have taken the breakfast, if the answer is yes, I have to do motor imagery. I have to imagine as if I am moving my right arm. So instead of saying yes, I have to imagine, right, for that question, I have to imagine the motor imagery task. If the answer is no, I should not say no. Instead of no, what the subject has to do is, he has to imagine the inner speech. And now you can understand, instead of directly giving an yes, no, I translate this simple activity into a mental activity response for yes differently and then no differently. So that this mental activity, we clearly understood, it has a specific region in the brain that is going to activate. So it has a specific spatial resolution where we are going to have the signal is going to be triggered. So I can easily measure. So we just see, you can exploit spatial. So you can just see, this slide gives you the information about the spatial, temporal, and then the magnitudinal information for information encoding in FNIRS for BCI application. So spatial you would have already aware. Now what is this temporal information encoding? So let us say now when I want to answer a multiple choice question, let us say I have a case study on this, but I don't know whether if time permits, we'll move to that case study. You can just see now, if you have a multiple choice question, let us say I have a three choice A, B, C. Then I can ask the subject, if I ask a question, if the choice is A, you can instantly, when the question is asked, at 0 second, you can give a response. And then if the choice is B, I can ask the subject to wait for first choice to complete. I just say first 10 seconds is given for choice A. I wait for the 10 seconds to complete, and if choice is B, then he has to give a response at 11th second. After the 10 second, he has to give a response. If his choice is C, and he can wait for the second choice to complete for 10 seconds, and then he can give a response at 21st second. So I can just timestamp the response. So accordingly, I can select the choice A, B, or C. And it is not necessary that you need to have a three choice, you can have more choices. But you need to clearly indicate what is the duration for first choice, second choice, and accordingly the subject has to select the response. And then the third exploitable FNRS signal feature is magnitude. And in my case study, I just showed two different arithmetic tasks. One is finding the sum of two numbers which results the answer 10. The other thing is calculator task. I already told you the difficulty level when I compare it with the first one. The second one is slightly more difficult. So the response that I'm going to get for the baseline is the reference. From that, how much magnitude the activity that is going to happen. So you can just see here, let us say this is my, the first graph is my baseline response. If I do a first arithmetic, it's slightly more than that. If I do a second thing, it is slightly more. So you can have a task difficulty level, and based on that, the magnitude of the FNRS response can change. So I can quantify the magnitude variation. I can create the command based on these magnitude variation. So this is how you need to do the information encoding in FNRS based BCA application. So I already told you, you can have intentionally controlled mental activities like mental calculation, mental speech, or mental singing, sometimes mental imaginary tasks like motor, visual, auditory, tactile, and emotional imaginary. Or sometimes you can also do a selective attention task like visual, auditory, and tactile. And then you can do automatic cognitive processing. This automatic cognitive processing, mostly they go with the person who is completely paralyzed, who is bedridden, they are not able to move their hand, and then or any mental activity is not possible, they have only the redundant ongoing cognitive processes there, then you can sense it. So these are the different ways where you can sense it. Now, do we have time, ma'am? Can I go with this case study?
Grace,
yes, sir, you can proceed.
I can proceed.
Yes, sir, you can proceed.
Okay. So this is a specific case study, a multiple choice FNRS based communication BCI. But this work is not done by me. It is done in the Manchester University. I'm just taking it as an example to show the audience how you can do a task where a specific application can be created. So you can just see now the application is, you need to create a communication based BCI, right? And you can just see some of the techniques available, the hemodynamics, we already aware, fMRI and FNARS. And then you can just see no paradigm, you cannot use it in the clinical setting. We need to go for the multiple choice paradigm, that is what we need to discuss today. So let me say, I clearly stated, right, the answer encoding by exploiting temporal FNARS signal feature. So you just see in this slide, you have an multiple choice question. I have four choices, A, B, C, D. So if I want to give a response A, so we just see this first 20 seconds is baseline, and then if my choice is A, I start responding after the baseline, so I have the response for A. So if my choice is B, I can just say I need to. So here the instructions, the auditory cue or the instruction to the participant before the task starts, it should be very clear. So how he has to select the temporal thing, and then he has to respond to the question. So you can just see now if the choice is B, so it is going to be after baseline 10 seconds, so that the C completes and then he has to give a response. So this is we need to clearly explain the subject what he has to do when he wants to answer a multiple choice question. So now you can just see you can as I already told you, for a question you cannot directly give an answer yes, no. So in this case, for answering a question, you try to have a mental task, something called mental drawing. So here the subject is asked to imagine how he is drawing a simple geometric figures such as circle, triangle, cubes. Or you can even draw small contours like a star, car, or even some pictures. But now he needs to imagine. So the imagination is very important. The subject has to imagine as if he is drawing a simple figures, simple geometric figures. So this is one type of encoding that we do, right? I already told you the BCI signal characteristics encoding. So this is how we do. So in this case, you can just see now the encoding, the answer encoding with auditory guidance. So I'm going to ask the question, what is your favorite color? So the color, the choices that is given to the subject are red, green, black, and he may not have a choice between these three, he can select the other color. So you can just see the instruction is very clear. He has to give the response at after the 20 seconds of baseline, he has to give the response at 20 seconds. If it is B, at 30 seconds. If it is C, it is at 40 seconds. So this is how the task is performed, and then the response is recorded. So this is the expected ideal FNARS response. But practically, you may not have this response. You can just say this is what the practical response that we got a little bit later. I'll just show you. So this is how the general procedure happens. So in the pre-session, we need to train, because just I call the person, I ask you to imagine as if you do drawing something. It is very difficult. So I need to have some pre-session. You need to train the subject. What is the task? So he has to be used to it. I will just say he has to be habited to that particular task. So that he, or I'll just say in the other way, he has to be familiarized with that task so that you have a good evoked response when the subject does that task. And then I'm going to have a questionnaire. Well, because in the example I showed you, I'm going to ask you what is the color. So I need to know what is the answer from the subject previously. So that I'll just say this is equal to a ground truth value. With this questionnaire response, when I ask the question randomly to the subject, when he gives the answer, whether he gives the choice that is being previously given to the questionnaire, whether it's a correct or wrong, I can easily sense it. That is what my objective is. So then you go for the NARS session, you get the any human experimental. You need to get a written consent. So that is what we do in the institution, where we have an ethical clearance, and then we have a consent with the particular participant. This is what we are going to do, and this is the instruments that we are going to use on you, and we need to be very clear that it is safe, and then you need to get a written consent. Then we need to place the opcodes, and then you need to select the channel of interest, and then you try to record the data. So this is they have run it with the two sets with 22 channel and then 27 channel. But what I have in my lab is only the two channel that what I have developed. So it is the data acquisition done is with the commercially available. It is this cloud machine. They have recorded the data. So you can just see this is the time course inspection of the localizer data for selecting the best channel. So So I just showed you have 22 channels and 27 channels. So first you need to select the best channel. So now comes the analysis part. So I previously told you the analysis can be done in three different ways, by just studying the activation analysis, or by just looking into the connectivity analysis, or hemisphere lateralization analysis. But here the thing that we that they have used is analyzing the best channel based on the magnitude of activation. Which channel had a maximum activation, they have selected that channel, and then they have taken that channel data for classifying the response as A, B or C for the specific question that's being asked. So this slide gives you the information about which channel has the best response. And they had a GLM analysis, that is the general linear model, which analysis the maximal mean of oxy and then the deoxy value. So they had this channel SD, they detected 8 channels the best response. So once the thing is done, the response is measured, you go for the ideal response, what is the real time response that they have got. So you can just say this is the ideal response that is expected, and this is the practical response that they got for each question that is being asked. And they also, since their lab is sophisticated lab, they also have this fMRI machine for the same subject. They have done it with the fMRI, and they have compared the response of fNARS with fMRI. And this comparison can give you the clear information that fNARS data is more or less giving a similar response with respect to the fNARS. So this is the typical response of the best channel, where you have the choice, right? And then this is the example question that is being asked and what the subject has given. So you can clearly understand now the subject answer is this choice for the color is red. That is what the you can clearly understand the response that the subject has given. Then I can also go for analysis in a detailed way, right? You can do the analysis, and then you can come out with a classification accuracy, at what rate the classification is done. So for doing this, you can extract specific features, and then you may go into detail about the various translation methods or various machine learning techniques. Anyway, we have a next session tomorrow to have a specific session on machine learning techniques for BCA application, where you will know about more detail about linear and non-linear classifier, support vector machine, and then linear discriminant analysis, and so on. And now currently we have the current scenario with CNN, they also use it for this application. So I'm not an expert in this machine learning area. I'm basically an instrumentation engineer, where I develop hardware and try to analyze some extent how the hardware works with a specific application. So the take-home message is, from the signal you can acquire features, and then using these features you can translate into command by which the external device can be controlled. Then I have a small video to indicate that the performance of this fNARS system with respect to the movement. I'll just stop sharing this screen for a while. So you can just see now, this is a commercially available machine. It is NARS POW. So the aim of presenting this video is how your NARS system, it can be a dynamic, and it how it can be a portable one, and how you can do various experiments. So the subject is wearing the device, and you can just see now he is going to do different types of tasks. So these are the tasks that he is going to do. You can just see now, initial baseline rest, then plank, and then push-ups, then jumping jack, running up and down in staircases. So you can imagine now how various movements that the subject is going to do, and during that time how the signal is going to be acquired. Now you can just see it is initial baseline crest. So now he is going to do the implant task, and you can observe here the changes when he does the task. How in the motor cortex region, how the changes are happening. So you can just see the changes. The total hemoglobin is the parameter that's being taken into consideration to show these changes. So now he is jumping jack. Now even he is climbing up and down in the staircase. So the aim of showing this video is to is my slide is visible, ma'am? Hello?
Yes, sir. It's
okay. Visible. It's visible.
Oh, okay. So the aim of showing this video is to tell you how your system is resistance to this motion artifact, and then how you could you are able to record for various physical activity. It is not that just the mental activity the subject does and then you record. It is not necessarily always mental activity. You can do the physical activity and then you can also record the data. So the advantage of FNARS as a BCI technique, so it is relatively low purchase or operating cost. When I say relative low purchase, it is in comparison with fMRI. So it is not with the EEG. When I say when I compare it with EEG, it is more costly. Then the second advantage is it is medium temporal resolution. So only thing is you need to understand the hemodynamic delay that is going to happen. And then the third advantage is you have sufficient spatial resolution, and it is not vulnerable to electromagnetic environment like EEG or fMRI, where the external environment or the power line interference, since it's an optical signal, you don't have these issues. And then you would have, after seeing this video, you would have understood it is relatively low sensitive to motion artifact, and you don't have a inverse problem as you have in EEG, and you have a ease of application, and it is portability. So this is the hardware. We have seen the video how portable the device is. And it is harmless. The lights that we use, it is not an ionizing radiation. It is just the near infrared. It is not going to harm you. And you can, when I say harmless, you can repeat for number of trials. So that is what I mean here, the harmless. I can use this light for more number of trials. And it is non-invasive. It is noiseless. In fMRI, you have a huge noise here. When the patient enters into an MRI couch, fMRI couch, he need to wear an ear plug. So auditory cues, sometimes it may be difficult in fMRI scenarios. But here it is not the issue. And it can be compatible. You can have compatibility with medical, paramagnetic medical equipment, which means that it can be fused with, the fusion of two modalities is possible. And then you can measure both oxy and deoxygenated hemoglobin, whereas in fMRI you can do either only one. And it is compatible with the other techniques like EEG, fMRI, and then this magnetic stimulator or transcranial stimulator, it is also possible. There are commercial versions where we have this TMS and TCS integrated with the fMRI, sorry, with the FNARS is available. But only thing is the cost and the affordability of the equipment. So every modality has a limitation. Similarly, FNARS also has a limitation. So it is light scattering when the superficial skin or the tissue, when you have a dark skin and when the hair is more denser, in these cases, you may have a possibility of getting the lesser intensity of the signal. And then the depth at which the signal you can get or you can reach, it is just the 3 cm depth I can go. And still there are some existing practical limitations in terms of placing the electrodes on the, the optodes on the scan. So these are some of the limitations that you have with respect to the FNARS. And then the application of FNARS, the application is not limited. It is you can use it. You can just see it can be used on infants. It can be used on children. It can be used on adults, and it can be used on patient groups of various categories of disease. It can be used in rehabilitation, and the action study. You can study all these actions like auditory, visual, cognition, motor activity, language, distinct state, somatosensory, visual. All these activities you can study. So in summary and conclusion, I'll just say FNARS constitutes a promising DCI technique. So it is non-invasiveness, harmlessness, portable, ease of use, high single drive reliability, high flexibility, relatively low cost when I compare it with fMRI. So I conclude stating that high potential for further improvement of FNARS methodology both in hardware and software. So FNARS is highly suited for clinical and daily life DCI application. And I'm finished. If you have any queries, I'm ready to answer.
Thank you, sir, for the section. It was a very detailed explanation about the research that you have carried out. And thank you for also showing some of the demos so that the participants can understand the details and what are the areas in which people can work or do research in this using this particular methodology and approach. Thank you so much, sir. So there are some few questions that are posted by the participants. First question, when you're going for temporal analysis, will the delay feature of FNARS will be a problem?
Yeah, definitely it will be a problem when you take the temporal features. So that is what, when you have a real-time application, when you want to derive a control signal based on this FNARS, always your control signal should take in account the delay, and then you need to manipulate your control signal to control your external device.
Okay. And the second question is, can we get image easily for research? What is the tool used for analysis?
You cannot get the image easily now. It is the signal. And then the signal, what I have, I can plot in a two-dimensional. I need to have a matrix of array of the sensor, and then I need to get a denser information. Then I can interpolate, I can get the image. But there are researches going on to get the image, like images, but access to these images is very difficult. Only if you have the facility, you will get the access. But there are very few databases, the open access databases are available, but access to these data is very difficult.
One more question from the participant. Rather than going for binary 1 or 0, can we work on something with a more fuzzy approach like 70% no and 30% yes?
With respect to the this yes, no, or fuzzy approach, I already told you, getting a response from the brain to an yes, no, is slightly, with respect to the temporal resolution and then pick the signal, it is very difficult. With respect to FNR, if with respect to EEG, you can do it. But with FNRS, it's slightly difficult. That is the reason why we always say we need to map it with the particular mental task or any physical task, and then the subject has to do it. So you can have fuzzy approach, but the results, it all depends on how the subject is going to respond to it.
Thank you, sir, for clarifying the doubts to the participants. Dear participants, if you have any other questions, would you please post it immediately on the chat box? I think there is no more question, I think. Sir, I thank you so much for the very detailed explanation about the methodology that you have followed, and especially I'm very much amazed to see the last demo about how the brain activity works when a person jumps onto the staircase and then do a lot of exercises. It's very amazing. Thank you, sir, for sharing your expertise with all of us. Thank you so much. Back to Grace, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir. Really, it is a very informative session, and also it's a very clear and detailed explanation about this FNR. It's really good, and really we would like to have future research collaboration and also all these things with you, sir. Really, it's good.
I'm ready to have a collaboration. No issues.
I should
thank your management for giving me this opportunity to have an interaction with.
Thank you so much, sir, and participants. I hope they would have benefited out of this session. Really, thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, sir. Participants, thank you all for joining us. I hope this session would be a very useful and informative session. And tomorrow, the session will be handled by Dr. Anila, ma'am. And she'll be taking about machine learning techniques for BCA applications. I hope tomorrow you will join. Thank you. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.